My name is Diane Gomez. I'm the state director for the Convention of States here in Indiana, and I really appreciate you all coming out tonight. We have a great evening with some wonderful speakers who've come from different parts of the country. But right now, let's start out with a Pledge of Allegiance. If you would please stand.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands,
one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And now Gary Hall is going to lead us in an invocation.
Dear Lord, we come to honor you this day. We come to acknowledge that you are the only one who can rightly guide our country. We ask that you will bless our country with your wisdom, your love, and compassion. May we be a people who are pursuing you and your plans for us. You are the source of all that is good. You are the source of all of our blessings. We thank you for every gift that we have been given. We also thank you for the opportunity to come together and gather this day. We ask for your hand of blessing on this meeting. We ask that you would guide and direct our meeting so that it is full of wisdom, productivity, and respect for one another. Thank you for helping us to accomplish our work and our goals this day. Amen.
Thank you, Gary. And I'd also like to thank Gary. He is a volunteer here in Fort Wayne, our regional coordinator, who made tonight possible, has arranged for it to be filmed. So this will be circulated on Access TV at a later date. Like many of you, I have felt despair about the direction of our country. And I have been looking for a solution for a long time. And I believe I found it in the Convention of States. So tonight is about one thing. We the people have the right to propose amendments at the state level. That's what we're about, and we are organizing like we have never organized before at the state legislative level. We have a couple of speakers, and they're going to come up, and if you would please hold your questions till the end. And I would also like to thank Senator Travis Holdman, who is here and is our sponsor, and appreciate him taking time out on his schedule to be with us tonight. Yeah, thank you, Senator Holdman. Our first speaker is Bob Berry, and he is our regional director. He's come in from Colorado, and he has written a couple of books about Article 5, and speaks regularly about it. He's an expert, and he was involved with Article 5 before it was even a movement. He came here a couple weeks ago for a meeting that we had in Anderson and Carmel, and have really enjoyed working with him and getting to know him. So I know you'll enjoy hearing his comments. So if Bob, you would come up.
Alrighty. You know, I forgot one thing. I was going to put a lavalier mic on. If you could excuse me for a moment, I'm going to do that. So I can walk around a little bit. Sorry about that. We got the bottom of the conversation. Alrighty. Now everybody can hear me? Okay, very good. Thank you all so much for coming out tonight. All right, here we go. So we want to begin kind of the evening talking about sort of the mechanics of Article 5 and why we think it's so important. You know, we do have a situation in the country where a lot of us have gotten to the point where we're in despair. We see the direction. It doesn't take an expert to put a trend line on this thing and say, we got some big problems in this country. We got some problems that need correction immediately. And it seems that no matter what we do, we end up not only not making progress, but a lot of times we end up going backwards. And so one of the things I always like to take time to do is, you know, I always wonder whenever I speak to a group, how many of you were active in any way with the Tea Party movement? Okay, that's a lot of hands. That's a lot of hands. So I'd like to point out that we are, in a very large part, standing on the shoulders of people who were active in the Tea Party movement. The Tea Party movement, nobody saw coming. It came out of nowhere, and its objective was to do one thing, and it was to elect the right people. And so it's kind of interesting as an observer, because I was not involved in the Tea Party movement. I was out doing writing about economics, involved in my career, going about my everyday life, because you see, quite some time ago, I had nearly given up on this. I had been active in politics and public policy over 20 years ago when I used to live in Virginia. And I got to the point where I voted every year and I did little things around the edges, but I never could be called again what I once was in my 20s, and that was I was not an activist. And so when I saw a lot of activists come out of nowhere with the Tea Party, that impressed me. When I saw these people showing up at rallies, and they're people that I thought were just like me, and I respected the way they conducted themselves. These were not people who were screaming at the cameras. These were people who were not carrying on. And one of the things that I thought was especially interesting is when Tea Party people came out to rallies, even in Washington, D.C., and the big ball and things like that, they left the place cleaner than when they had arrived. So what that told me is that these people had class, that these were decent people. And I think almost as much as anything else the Tea Party stood for, it was that dignity, it was that class that communicated, that resonated with the American public. And once again, a lot of people who previously had given up were now re-engaged. The Tea Party's mission was to elect the right people. We wanted to hit the reset button and start over. We wanted to see if we could, by participating in the system, if it would work. And in 2010, you saw this amazing movement come, and it came to a crescendo, and as a result of that, we had a changeover in the legislature again. And we had a lot of Republicans. We had something like 76 brand new members of Congress turn Congress back over to a Republican institution, and you had the House was going to, the first thing they all ran on was they were not going to raise the debt ceiling. You remember this discussion? The reason we care about this is we are about to see a replay of this in really just a few days. The 3rd of November, this is coming up again. And because that was the topic of interest during that campaign, a lot of the people who were running for office that year took it up as their main part of their campaign. They just assimilated into their campaign, and it's really all they ran on. And so we were sure that the first thing that they were going to do when they got to Washington was to not extend the debt ceiling. The debt ceiling for years and years, this is basically how the country goes into debt. They appropriate a certain amount of money, they put a ceiling on the amount of debt, the amount of borrowing power, and then they reach it, and they summarily increase it. And the thing that always cracked me up about this, watching this for years and years and years, is you have in Washington the in party, that's the party that has the presidency, and you have the out party, the party that doesn't have the presidency. And what happens is, the in party always wants to raise the debt ceiling, and the out party is always dead set against it. Okay? And the problem is they keep switching sides. Because every time you have a turnover, all of a sudden, it's a whole new ballgame. Barack Obama in 2006 said it was an outrage that George Bush wanted to raise the debt ceiling. A couple years later, he's president of the United States. He thought it was an outrage that the Republicans didn't want to raise the debt ceiling. You need a program to figure out what side they're going to be on this week. That's a problem. What does that tell you? That tells you we got a serious problem because they are playing, it's a political football, all right? But things were going to be different this time because in 2010, we elected 70-some people who were absolutely not going to raise the debt ceiling. What happened? They came to Washington, D.C. to change Washington, D.C., and almost before they were sworn in, Washington, D.C. had changed them. Now, this is a topic that I can speak about with some authority because that is where I am from. I grew up just north of Washington, D.C. in Maryland, and my father was involved. He was a regulatory attorney in Washington and interacted quite a bit with the government. And it was kind of funny because my father was able to tell me, even as a child, what was going to happen the next day's news before it happened. And I thought he was a genius. He was a genius, but he also had kind of the inside scoop on, and he knew these guys. He knew them like a book. And he was always able to say, look, they will always take care of number one, and number one is us. And once you get into that rarefied atmosphere where you never have to wait in line, where you never have to worry about a parking space and all these things, I mean, this is what happens. And so all these guys go to Washington, D.C., and they got something close to a play ball speech. And the play ball speech is very simple. You're going to vote the way we want you to vote. And if you do that, we'll make sure you get reelected. I remember when I lived in Virginia, we had a guy who was from the central district, one of the central districts of Virginia. And I got a list of his contributors. This guy had gone bad. We elected a really great guy. Actually, I knew this guy. And after two or three re-elections, there was nothing that resembled the guy that we elected. And so I got a list of his contributors. I don't even know why I did that, but I did that. And one of the things I noticed on this list was a max out contribution from the Hawaiian Pineapple Growers Association. Let me remind you, this guy is in Virginia. So I asked my father about this. And I said, what in the world is this? And my father told me, he said, this is a very simple thing. He said, you get the play ball speech, and it essentially goes like this. You're going to vote the way we want you to vote. And if you do, we're going to take care of the re-election as long as you want to stay here. You vote the way your constituents want you to vote, then all these contributors are going to be involved in your next race, but they're going to be on the other side of the primary, and you are going to go down as an asterisk in history as some guy who came here and served one term, and we sent him home packing. That is how things work in Washington, D.C. So it should have come as no surprise to me, having had this education, that when all but 20 or so of these brand new freshman Republicans who ran on not raising the debt ceiling came into power and they folded. And this happened in July of 2011. And that was when, I remember watching this, and they did it in a very arcane way so that it would be hidden, so that all but very people who are really watching this wouldn't really know what had happened, because it happened in kind of a backroom deal on a committee somewhere, and as far as everybody knew, one minute it was front page news, and the next minute it disappeared. Poof. And that's how things happen. And everybody, a couple weeks later, were like, what happened? How did that happen? But this time we were watching. Now, that would lead most people to give up again, if they had previously given up, as I had. But this so annoyed me that that's when I said, you know, this country is worth saving, and I'm sure a lot of people are thinking the same thing that I'm thinking. Well, is there some kind of a mechanism? Is there something, I'm not looking for a silver bullet necessarily, but do we have any hope at all? And this is about the time that I actually rediscovered Article 5. And when I say rediscovered, the 20 years ago or so, when I was first introduced to Article 5, there was a subtlety that caused me to miss the point of Article 5 for two decades. And the subtlety was, back in the day, that was summarily referred to as a constitutional convention, which it is not. The Constitution actually has a name for this. It is known as a convention for proposing amendments. Now, what do you suppose a convention for proposing amendments does? It proposes amendments. That's its name. That's what it's called. It's also known as Convention of States. Okay, those are the same things. It is not a constitutional convention, but because of that subtlety, and because of that slight difference in terminology, because of that common word, a lot of people have gotten the wrong impression about what this thing is. So whenever I talk about this, I always like to take a moment or two and talk about kind of the mechanics of this, because it's really not that simple. In fact, we're looking at Article 5 here. The important part of Article 5 is really only 93 words long. And so at this point, after this cave-in on the debt ceiling vote, I went to my Constitution, and I went back to Article 5 and I gave it another read. And I got so interested in it, I started looking up some of the more recent scholarship that is on this, and I found a treasure trove of recent, excellent scholarship by a gentleman by the name of Robert G. Nadelson, who was later to become a friend and actually edit my first book on this topic. And so let's talk just for a moment about what is going on in Article 5, because this is kind of important, okay? So the Congress has a role, and the Congress, what does it say the role is? Whenever two-thirds of both houses shall deem it necessary, shall propose amendments to this Constitution. They shall propose amendments to this Constitution. That's a good place to pause for a moment, because constitutional amendments are a two-phase affair. It is proposal followed by ratification in the states, okay? So here we have the way that amendments have been proposed throughout our history. Congress does the proposing, okay? Or, that or is a very important or, because what that tells you is there's an alternative to Congress doing the proposing. And that alternative is on the application of the legislatures of two-thirds of the several states shall call a convention for proposing amendments, which in either case shall be valid to all intents and purposes as part of this Constitution. Stop. Let's back up. On the application of the legislatures of two-thirds of the several states. So what does that mean? That means that the states have a means by which they can propose amendments too. That is a power only in the first phase of the amendment process, they too have an opportunity to propose. This is another important place to pause, because this is intentional. The reason the founders did this, and it's kind of a fun story, because this only really occurred in the last couple days of the Constitutional Convention. This was inserted. That last part about the states proposing amendments was nearly left out. And if it wasn't for George Mason, we wouldn't have that. And they found, when they thought this through, they said, wait a minute. If we don't provide a way for the states to propose amendments, what if the federal government runs away and goes out of control? There will be no way for the states to balance that out. And remember, we've written this Constitution. We spent all these months here working on this thing, creating a system of checks and balances. And I would contend that we are looking at maybe the biggest check and balance in the entire Constitution, because what this is doing, if you think about it, this is the check and balance that is responsible for maintaining the balance between the power in the states and the power in Washington, D.C. Okay? Continuing. So the application of the legislatures of two-thirds of the several states, so we need two-thirds of the states. Now that would be 34 states in order to trip this. So what does this mean? This means that the states, when they want to have this assembly, this convention for proposing amendments, they've all got to get together. And they've got to pass an application that says, hey, federal government, Article 5 of the Constitution says that we have an equal right to propose amendments to the Constitution, not ratify, just the proposed part, okay? We'll ratify later, just like all the other amendments, but we want to have a discussion, and we might want to propose some amendments, okay? In either case, once it's ratified, they'll be valid to all intents and purposes as part of this Constitution. Another very important point, because what it means is there's no second-class amendments. That if you do amendments proposing it through the Congress or through the state-initiated process, if the states go on to ratify these, and we'll talk about that in a moment, those amendments are just as important as any other amendment in the Constitution. Okay? Next group. When ratified by the, so it's valid part of the Constitution, when ratified by the legislatures of three-fourths of the several states, or by conventions in three-fourths thereof. Let me stop there. What is that all about? So let's kind of back up. So we can get a proposal two ways. We can go through Congress, you need two-thirds of Congress to get a proposal from them. Or you can go through the states, where you need two-thirds of the states to say, we want a convention so we can discuss some amendments, okay? And if you have that convention and they do propose amendments, then you're not done. In fact, you're only in the middle of the process. Because now, no matter how they've been proposed, they have to go around to the states, and you need to get three-quarters of the states. So today, that would be 38 states. This is a pretty high bar. You're getting an impression that this is something that is taken very seriously by the Constitution. This is not a willy-nilly kind of a thing. This is serious business. Or by conventions in three-fourths thereof. I'm going to use my pointer here. So this part here is kind of a interesting little footnote. That has only been... So when you have amendments that are proposed, Congress gets to decide the method of ratification. You still need three-quarters of the states, but there's actually two ways you can get the states to say yes or no. The traditional way is it goes to the state legislatures, and the state legislatures say up or down. Okay? Notice that the governor is never a part of this process, nor is the president a part of this process. Very interesting. So this is strictly a state legislature affair. The other option, which has only been used one time in our history for an amendment, is little mini conventions in each state. Those are ratification conventions, where they literally show up, and these can be regular citizens, or however the state decides to hold its own little convention that's just a ratification convention. They show up and they say, yeah, we like that amendment, or no, we don't like that amendment, and it's over. They go home, okay? And that's only been used one time, and that was, if anybody knows, does anybody have any idea when was the one time that was used? Anybody knows? That's to repeal prohibition. It was the only time that was ever used in our history. But that's just as legitimate a thing. By the way, just a footnote. So in a few minutes, we're going to get into some of the conspiracy theories and some of the runaway scenarios that people are afraid of, who don't really understand. This is why we're taking some time to explain this a little bit tonight. There were people who, when that amendment was sent to the states, and the method was chosen by Congress to have ratification conventions, what I like to call little mini conventions in each state, there were people who were terrified about this idea. They said, oh my goodness, that's never been done. We don't know what's going to happen. You know what's going to happen? Every state is going to have their constitution, their state constitution, rewritten. And there was all kinds of angst about this. It didn't happen. Kind of an interesting little footnote to history. So, the last part of it is really operative only at a particular time, so we're not going to really go in there, but that's the process, right? Proposal, ratification, you can propose something by Congress, you can propose something by a convention of the states. We are the Convention of States Project. And the Convention of States Project, our whole objective is to use this provision in the Constitution. This is very much a use it or lose it proposition. If we do not use this important check and balance in the Constitution, I fear that we will lose this republic because things are badly out of balance. When the Constitution gives you checks and balances and they are not used, you get out of balance. And one of the more interesting quotes from kind of one of the unsung heroes of the founding era was a guy by the name of Tench Cox. You probably never heard of Tench Cox before. And he was asked after the Constitutional Convention, how do you know that you did the right thing here with this Constitution? How do you know you have this all the proper checks and balances? And he had a brilliant answer. He said, you know, we can't. We can't. Because people are saying, how can you guarantee? How can you absolutely guarantee this thing is not going to go nuts? That this federal government is not just going to become a monster? And because their whole premise was, you got to be careful because things have a tendency to go that way. Right? So his answer was, hey, we can't know. What we've done, though, in Article 5, is we've created a provision that if we've given the federal government too much power, we can't know if we've given them too much power. We don't know if we've not given them enough. But what we have done is we've given both sides of that equation the ability to propose amendments, but the ratification of those amendments ultimately have to go to the sovereigns. And in our system of government, who are the sovereigns? It is the states. The states are sovereign. And so the states get the final say on every amendment, no matter who proposes it. So that's why that is so important. Okay? Now the next question you might be thinking is, okay, that's kind of cool. We've never done this in history, by the way. We've come close a number of times. But we've never pulled it off. And one of the reasons we've never pulled it off is most of the time when there's been some issue that the American public has become concerned about, they were able to get down to the 1 yard line, and Congress usually is able to run to the front of that that thing and say, oh, here's a Congress-friendly version of this, you see, and you know, we could do it this way, okay? So one example of this in recent history was the balanced budget was very, very close to tipping. It was 34. We got to within about 32 states. So we were only two away, late 80s, early 90s. And so does anyone remember the Graham-Rudman Act? So Graham-Rudman was introduced as, no, we don't need, now look, we don't need to get carried away here. We don't need to go amending the Constitution for a balanced budget or anything because we're going to do it in Congress. We're going to do a five-year plan. And we're going to balance this budget on our own, okay? And like most five-year plans in Washington, I think it lasted 2.5 years or so, which is actually kind of long for Washington. And then it was forgotten about, okay? During this same period of time, remember I mentioned a moment ago about the conspiracy theories, a popular movement came out of nowhere, writing this off as a constitutional convention and scaring the living daylights out of everybody. And at the time, we didn't have the good scholarship that we have now about this issue. And the people who were proposing the balanced budget amendment, which remember, had gotten 32, only needed two more, frankly didn't have their messaging in order. And as a result of their ill-preparedness to head off those arguments to do really what we hope to do, is answer the questions that people have about this process. Because they failed to do that, states began rescinding their applications. And we lost about half of them within just a few years. Now, that has to go down. As one of the greatest missed opportunities in history, because at that time, the national debt was under $2 trillion. Still a lot of money. You know what it is today, right? It's 18. You know what the real number is? When you count unfunded things, it's pushing 100 trillion or maybe over 100 trillion. It seems like an insurmountable amount of money. We can't pay that. That's a serious problem. But in the late 80s, we could have. How many times in history is an opportunity as big as that been missed? Okay? Now, we have to go beyond the balanced budget amendment because the problem is not just that we've got a budget that's out of control. We've got an entire federal government out of control. So So we wrote the Convention of States application to restore federalism, to go beyond just balancing the budget. We need to limit congressional terms so that these people can't go to Capitol Hill and camp out for the rest of their lives, and the whole time referring to themselves as public servants. Let's be honest. We're the servants. Isn't that true? And everybody, and I hate saying that. It makes me sick to have to say that. But if we're going to do our job, we have to call things as they are. And that's the fact of it. We have a ruling class now. We didn't used to have that in America. And I long for a quaint old time when the federal government was nothing more than a sideshow. We are determined to bring that back. We are determined to restore federalism. We are going to impose fiscal controls on Washington, D.C. We are going to have the kind of reform that we need in this country, and that's a very important point. Because in order to correct a problem, you have to have a solution that is equal to the problem. If you tinker around the edges, and just do half measures, you will have nothing. And as big a fan of the balanced budget as I am, at this point, it is not enough. We have to go beyond that, okay? The thing I like to concentrate on more than anything else, I do a lot of radio, I speak to a lot of groups, and I think people who think the way I think most of us in this room think is, we tend to be very good at problem identification. You know, the federal government's out of control, et cetera, et cetera. We're not so good on solutions. And so one of the things I always like to do is, we gotta look at the solutions, because if you focus on the problem, that's all you're going to see. We have to think about the solution. And this is a solution that is equal to the problem. And I want you to just imagine what we can do with this thing. Imagine if we can cut Washington back to size. Imagine if we can put it back in its box. Imagine the freedom that we're gonna have for ourselves and for our children and for our grandchildren. Do you have any idea of the potential if we are to release this country back to the free country that it used to be when Washington, D.C. was a sideshow? When you walk, you go through your whole life and you maybe never bump into a federal official except for maybe the mailman? Okay, that's what I want. That's what I want for myself, that's what I want for my children, that's what I want for my grandchildren. And my guess is a lot of you think the same thing. If we can put them back in their box, then we can bask in really a new golden age. And this is the point I have to make. One of the things I always admired about Reagan, who came to power, if you remember, and I don't like that phrase, come to power, came to the presidency, in a very troubled time. This is about the time I was in high school. I was 16 years old when Reagan was elected, first time. And at that time, it was looking very bad. We had 13% unemployment. We had 20% inflation. Interest rates were nuts. I mean, it was like some kind of a meltdown was going on. And we were having this, as Jimmy Carter so aptly put it, Jimmy Carter with a keen grasp of the obvious, said that it was a crisis of confidence. Well, yeah. And that's not a great time to be a graduating teen in high school. You've got the whole rest of your life to look forward to. But this guy came out of nowhere, this older actor guy who had been the governor of California, and he showed up in Washington and he was optimistic. And it was genuine. He really believed in the American people. And if I had to characterize the movement, and you know, Diane mentioned this, when I got involved with this thing, this wasn't a movement, this was an idea. This was kind of an obscure academic idea that had been sleeping for 30 or 40 years. And it's come out of obscurity, very much like the Tea Party came out of obscurity, and now it is an accomplishing thing, and now it is a genuine movement. And the ethos of this movement is a certain optimism. We had to go through the process of electing the right people, because we had to see whether that was going to work or not. It didn't work, okay? So now we are reconstituting that movement. This is the next stage of this booster rocket. And now we are saying something a little differently. And that is that we are invoking this important part of the Constitution. We are not taking no for an answer. We are going to do this. We are going to put you back in that box. And we're not asking. We're telling you. And that's what brings me to our state legislatures, because they are, if you will, our avenging angels in this fight, okay? They are the people who are going to make this happen. And that's why it's very important that all of us talk to our legislatures, let them know what you think about this thing. They have got to know that you have their back. If we do not have a proper grassroots movement behind those legislators, they will not have what they need to get this thing through the finish line. And this has to be accomplished in state after state after state. In Indiana, we have not just a majority in both houses of Congress. It is a supermajority. What is the number, Diane? Is it 70? 71%. That is a pretty significant majority. If we cannot get this accomplished in a state like Indiana, we are in very serious trouble. That's a very important thing to know. Here's the other thing I want to leave you with. I did a little bit of figuring today. I'd love to look at these numbers. This is going to be a historic event. If you get involved in this thing, you are getting involved in a part of history. Now, like a lot of the people of the founding generation, maybe nobody's going to know your names. But the people whose names are going to be known are going to be the legislators, like our friend Senator Holdman over here, who are going to have the opportunity to take leadership and make this thing happen. But all of you have got to be out there. So the question is, okay, we're going to have this amazing event, this convention of states. Congress has really very little power in this process, by the way. Once you trip the appropriate number of states, Congress chooses the time and the place. And that's it. And they wait for whatever amendments are proposed out of that, and then their job is to send it back out to the states for the ratification process. But when this assembly is meeting, you have to ask yourself, who's going to participate in this? What are the sensibilities of the people who are going to... How can we guarantee, remember the question of Tench Cox? How can we guarantee that this thing is going to do what we want it to do? How do we guarantee that something bad is not going to happen? Okay? That's a great question. Let me just give you a couple of numbers. Okay? We've got 50 states. In 31 of those states, those are Republican-controlled states, both houses of the legislature. Okay, or in the case of Nebraska, it's unicameral. It is basically Republican control. Okay, 31 states. In 11 states, those are Democrat-controlled states. Only 11 states. In 8 states, they are split, one of each. Traditionally, in conventions of states, because it's one vote, one state, or one state, one vote, I should say, a state that split deadlocks. So they're basically, if it's a partisan vote, they cancel each other out. So what does that mean? That means that we have 31 out of 42 states. You thought you had a supermajority in Indiana? In an assembly that I'm talking about, that majority is 73%. That is not a supermajority. I'll call that a super duper majority. Okay? Is anybody worried that an assembly with that composition is going to take away your right to free speech, or your right to bear arms, or is going to do anything crazy? What do you think a group of people constituted like that are going to propose? Remember, they can't even ratify their own amendments. All they can do is propose. They are going to restore federalism. And that is why we wrote the Convention of States application language, to be very, very simple. The other lesson we have from history, unlike the balanced budget amendment, which is an Article 5 effort also, is that we were able to coordinate our language so that it matched. Why is that important? Because guess who does the counting? Congress does the counting. And what do you want to bet if the language didn't match up properly, which I believe is the case with the balanced budget amendment effort, sadly, they are going to find any excuse they can to not count them to that all-important number of 34. So that's why we've learned some things with the Convention of States application language. So I want to leave you just with the thought of this. I don't like to talk about catastrophes. I'm not what you would call a catastrophist. A lot of people say, if we don't do this, we're going to go down the tubes and it's all over. I really prefer to say, remember that missed opportunity that I spoke of a minute ago back in the late 80s, early 90s, where we could have had a balanced budget, but we just missed it by that much, okay? Well, now the bad news is that we've got a bigger problem, so we have to have a bigger solution. Can you imagine if this time we don't miss that opportunity? If this time we seize the day and we fix this thing while it's still fixable? If we do that, our future is so bright, you're not going to believe it. And that's what I'm looking forward to. Thank you all very much. Oh. I forgot part of my job. So I want to introduce to you a gentleman that I've gotten to know here over the last couple of years, who is co-founder of this organization. Mark Meckler, many of you have heard about. You've probably seen him on TV. You've heard him on the radio. I'm sorry. Oh, Senator, that's right. I'm sorry. I'm getting ahead of myself. All right. Our sponsor, so I was talking about our legislators and how they need to hear from you and they need to know that you have their backs. Well, our sponsor in the state, in the Senate, is the next speaker, and he is really the guy that I think is going to make this happen in this state. We tried last year. We came very close. This year, we're going to take it over the finish line, and if we do take it over the finish line, it is going to be first in the Senate, and it is going to be because of the work of Senator Holdman. Senator, would you join me up here?
Thank you all for being here tonight. I had heard Senator Brown might attempt to be here tonight, but she's kind of on the campaign trail with her third district vote. But I just to say a few words about Senator Brown, she is a great fighter for Article 5 and all things conservative. And I'm sorry she's not here, but I'm sure she would be here. I talked to her just 2 days ago, and I know she'd planned to be here when we had a Right to Life meeting with area legislators to do some strategy work with her. I get involved with Article 5 work actually in just my second year that I was in the legislature, and proposed an Article 5 resolution that had to do with limiting the power of the federal government with regard to regulation, the Regulation Freedom Amendment, which I think is one of Mark Levin's proposed Article 5 topics that he proposes. If we did all those things, if you've read his book, if we did all the things that he did, this would certainly be a different country than what we have today. And realistically, I think we realize that we can't get all those things done. But limiting the regulatory authority of the federal government would certainly be a great step forward. I proposed the legislation in the form of a resolution, which is the method that would have to be done. And I realized early on, because of the work of two other groups in the state, and I'll just call them out, but I won't comment about them, one being Eagle Forum and the John Birch Society, mounted a terrific opposition to my legislation. And I was hearing from citizens all over the country, just not Hoosiers. I was hearing from people from New York to California and from the north to the south about what a terrible thing this was going to be if this would be proposed and this would pass. I went to Senator Long, who most of you are probably sitting in his district here, talked to him about the issue. He wanted something done, but he and I both realized it was not going to come to pass. But our method was to go to the chairman of the Judiciary Committee, where the bill had been assigned, and basically ask for a hearing, but told him that we did not anticipate that it would pass and he could hold it, but it was the method we had to at least get the issue out in the open so that we would have some discussion on that issue and start talking about this in Indiana. So that was about, I think that was 6 years ago, that we started crossing this barrier where it's free for us to talk about this issue, which hadn't been talked about in Indiana. I think it was in 1978 when the first call for a convention was laid out by the state of Indiana. We have mounted a good fight in Indiana, and we have passed legislation that was actually authored by our Senator Long, our President Pro Tem of the Senate, because he and I were two of the Senate delegates, the only Senate delegates from Indiana that attended the Mount Vernon Assembly that was held in December a couple of years ago in Mount Vernon, Virginia. And boy, what a historic moment. I just forget to ask Mark if he was there, and it was like, well, yeah, he can't be there because he wasn't a state legislator, because actually you couldn't get in the room unless you were a state legislator. I think there was over 100 state legislators from all over the country, which was the first call for legislators to come together to try to come to a resolution to have common language something that we've talked about here that was going to be necessary to remove any of that doubt from Congress that says you don't have a valid application because your application has a word in it that this application from this state doesn't have. And so we saw the need to have some uniformity in what we did. That group continues to meet, and actually coming up in just about 3 weeks in Salt Lake City, that group will meet again. The second meeting of that group, which is now the Assembly of State Legislators, I think is the name of the group. I still call it the Mount Vernon Assembly because I like that better. Their first meeting outside of Mount Vernon was actually in Indianapolis, which was pretty historic for the state of Indiana. And as we hopefully read in history books, or our great-grandchildren will read in history books, in 50, 75 years when this movement really got a footing, Indiana played a key role in that. And actually, Senator David Long, your senator from here in Allen County, was one of the biggest players in all of that. David volunteered to be on the executive committee for the Mount Vernon Assembly, and he has worked diligently with Representative Kapenga from Wisconsin and a number of other legislators, just not Republican legislators, but a few Democrats have been involved in this process as well. And this meeting is coming up in Salt Lake City just in a few weeks, but I've got another legislative meeting, a national meeting that I am committed to attend, and I will not be able, regrettably, I will not be able to attend the Salt Lake City meeting. One of the things that we have done in Indiana and has been copied across the country in states that have an interest in Article 5 is we have laid out what we call the faithful delegate law. If you haven't kept your eye on this, 2 years ago, we actually passed legislation in Indiana that says these are going to be the rules for delegates that we send to the convention. If you go to the convention and you don't vote the way you've been told to vote by the legislature, you can be recalled. If you vote against the way you have been instructed to vote, you can actually be recalled and you can be charged with a felony in the state of Indiana for voting against the will of the people. We think we have some good language. As I said, it's been copied in other states. Other states are using that. And the whole role of this group of legislators, folks, is to set the ground rules. How do we decide who gets elected? How do we decide what the number has to be? We need to lay those rules out, because if we don't lay them out, if there's any ambiguity, Congress is going to try to make up that rule for us. And so we need to do everything that we can to set those parameters for them to fix that. Back 6 years ago, when I introduced this legislation, I had these folks coming to me saying, you do not need to do this because there's going to be a runaway convention. We just need to elect people to Congress that will do the job. We have a system in place. We just need to use the system that we have in place to make change happen. And my response was, so how's that working for us right now? That isn't working for us. And at that time, we had about $10 trillion of national debt. And I said, when is enough going to be enough? Sorry to say, we're soon approaching $20 trillion of national debt. And I was absolutely amazed just the last time the debt limit was increased that our president actually looked in the camera and he said, just because you raise the debt limit doesn't mean you're going to increase the national debt. I don't believe he was an economics major in wherever he went to school, but he actually said those words. And that was another night when I sitting in front of the TV and I start yelling at the TV, and my wife tells me to get control of myself because I get out of control, it seems, particularly when one individual moves to the podium to speak on national television. We appreciate your support. What you're doing is a good work. We need to keep our foot on the pedal. We need to keep moving forward. We cannot give up in this fight because I have a 3- and a 5-year-old grandson and granddaughter that we cannot afford to back away from this thing. We have got to be pressing forward. Whether it's limiting terms for Congress, whether it's a debt limit, a balanced budget amendment, whether it's a limitation on federal regulation, whether it's a restriction of the use of the Commerce Clause for the courts to get their way, whether or not we have term limits on federal judges. These are the kinds of things that we need to be talking about with our neighbors, with those folks of that we see at church on Sunday, and people that we talk to every day about what is this country coming to, and it's time for us to take hold of that through Article 5 and fix this. Thank you for having me here tonight. I appreciate your time.
Remember what I said a few minutes ago about optimism? If I didn't absolutely believe that we were going to be able to pull this off, I would not be involved in this movement. I'm looking you right in the eyes, and I'm telling you that I've seen this thing go from an academic idea to an honest-to-goodness movement. It is not any longer a question with whether we're going to do this. It's a matter of when are we going to do this, and maybe how are we going to do this. And I can answer the second part of that. We're going to do it together, because that's the only way we can do this thing. We are Americans. Americans solve problems. We don't just sit around and curse the darkness. That is what makes us different. That's, by the way, one of the things that characterizes this movement. We are not a bunch of people who are sitting around waiting for the end to come. We are going to solve the problem. And that's a movement that I can get behind. Speaking of movements, the guy who I think helped, maybe more than anyone, bring this from an idea, from just an academic obscure idea, to the grassroots of this country, and really made a movement out of it, is the gentleman you're going to hear from next. This is somebody who we... Oh, that scared me for a second. This is a gentleman who is no stranger to grassroots movements. Many of you may know Mark Meckler as the co-founder of the Tea Party Patriots. So a few minutes ago I spoke about the Tea Party. Well, this was the guy who was there from the very beginning. And he got a hold of this idea, and like a bulldog, he said, this is it. This is absolutely the answer. And so now we can really thank Mike Ferris and a couple other people for providing the answers that he needed as he got interested in this movement. And he has, I think, nearly single-handedly, and he would not like me saying this, at least in the beginning, taking this before the American public and said, this is where we need to go. And this is the kind of leader that we have in Convention of States. Let me introduce Mark Meckler, the president.
I'm good. Well, thank you guys for being here tonight. This is an incredible facility, so I'm used to being in like one-room schoolhouses and stuff. And my office, believe it or not, at home is in a barn, so this is really upscale for me. So forgive me if I'm overly impressed with the auditorium you guys have here. I have this rare privilege and this really sort of different perspective on the country because I travel so much. And I've spent the last 6 years traveling around the country, doing grassroots activism, working with grassroots leaders all over the country, talking to people about what they think about the state of the country, where we're at, where we're going, hearing the stories of depression and sadness after certain elections and elation after others. And I'll tell you, I come out of it with a very strong belief in the future of this country. And I know that's different than a lot of people I cross paths with. You know, they're depressed. They say we send people to Congress and nothing changes. Doesn't matter who the president is. Look what the Supreme Court does. So there's a lot of people feeling like we really don't have a chance. And what gives me hope and inspiration and, in fact, certainty for the future course of this country is being with people like you. And I get to do this all over the country. I've been in 30 states so far this year, probably be 35 by the end of the year. Way too many miles in an airplane. Often when people ask me where I live, now I say in the seat of an airplane. And what I see out there is the same passion upon which this country was founded. You know, we read American history. And when we read American history, how many people have read more history in the last few years than they did growing up? Or see, that's really extraordinary to me. I get that same thing everywhere I go. Lots more people reading history. Now, I went to school. I grew up in Los Angeles, California. And so I went to LA County Public Schools, so probably the history I got was worse than most of you. But when we study history and we study American history, it's really an interesting way that we study. We study what I call the great man or the great person theory of history. So we study the people that made the news, essentially, back then. We study, if you're looking at the founders, you study Washington and Adams and Madison. You know, one of my favorites, Patrick Henry, they give me liberty or give me death speech, right? Those are the things we read about. Those are the moments in history that we pay attention to, and they're really important. I'm glad we do. We draw inspiration from them. We see what these people did, and they give us ideas and for our own lives. But I also think there's a problem with studying history that way. Because I don't know about you guys, but when I look at Washington or Adams, Madison, Henry, all these people, Tench, Cox, I think, I'm not them. I'm just a guy, you know, living in the country in Northern California. And what difference can I make in a country of 310, 320 million people? You know, I'm just coaching soccer and teaching my kids to ride horses and the country's falling apart. And what difference can I possibly make? Because we look at the people who made a difference, right? And they're big people. We almost deify them. The huge statues of them, and we read these incredible stories of them, and we've almost made them mythic figures. And so I think for a lot of us, I certainly for myself, I look at those people, it's really intimidating. I don't feel like I'm like any of those people. But if you look at American history and you really look at the real history of this country, it's not about Washington and Adams and Madison and all those great men and their families. It's really about regular people. That's what made America great. That's what's always made America great. If you look back at the American Revolution, sure, we know all those names, but what we don't know are the more important figures, in my opinion. The men who went out and gave their lives on the field of battle, right? The ones that didn't survive. Families who lost their farms, their businesses, families torn apart, right? A lot of them gave everything. We don't know most of those stories, but those are the people who made the American Revolution. You know, Jefferson talked about writing the Declaration of Independence, and he wrote a letter shortly before his death, and in this letter, it's one of the most modest statements you could ever see. He wrote about the Declaration, and he said, there was nothing new in there. We weren't inventing anything. We were just expressing the common sentiment of the average Whig of the time. That was the political party. That's all they were doing, is trying to express what people, just average folks, believe. Shopkeepers and bankers and merchants and farmers, that's what they believed. So it wasn't some extraordinary thing from on high. This is what average Americans thought. You know, we don't know most of their stories, but we do know one of them. There's a great story about a guy by the name of Captain Levi Preston. And Preston was one of the original Minutemen, right? Fought in the first battles of the American Revolution. And in 1843, there was a historian traveling the country. His name was Mellon Chamberlain. Chamberlain was 26 years old at the time. He was a school teacher and a self-appointed historian. His job, as he saw it, was to collect the oral histories of the great patriot Minutemen. In 1843, they were old. Right, these guys were in their late 80s, early 90s. There weren't a lot of them left. If you think about life expectancy back then, around 54 years for the average male, these guys were in their late 80s, early 90s. So Chamberlain knew that if he did not collect those stories, they would disappear. No YouTube back then, right? No video phones. So he had to go out and get those things. So he was traveling the country, and he crosses paths with Levi Preston in North Carolina. Preston's 91 at the time that Chamberlain crosses paths with him. And he asks him why he fought in the Revolution. What brought him out on the field of battle? And I want to put that in context, because I think sometimes this is another thing we don't think about. These were farmers and merchants and just regular folks like us. And when they went to fight the Redcoats, it's as if I got on stage tonight and said, by the way, there's a battalion of Marines coming to town tonight, and I'd love you all to get together with me and go fight them. Right? It's crazy. It's crazy what these people did. It was impossible what was asked of them, and they did it anyway. And so Chamberlain wants to understand the motivations. What were the big philosophical motivations behind the American Revolution? And he asks Preston if he was offended by the Stamp Act, that he had to place stamps on all his documents and buy these stamps from the government, and, you know, if that was just so offensive to him that drove him to the field of battle. And Preston says, I never bought a one of them. Governor locked him in the armory, and that's the last we ever heard of it. So it's not that, I mean, we all read about the Stamp Act in grammar school, right, in junior high. So we asked him, well, maybe it was the tea tax, because we all read about the tea tax, right? We know about that. And he knew the same history you and I know. And so he says, was it the tea tax where you're just frustrated? And he said, I was a farmer. I never drank any tea. Boys dumped it in the harbor. That's all we knew. not the tea tax. So he understands the history, but he doesn't understand anything, he realizes. And he asks them, what about the great writers of the time, the great revolutionaries? Were you reading them and you were inspired by their words? And he said, we read the Bible, the Psalms, and some of us read the Almanac, but that's about all. Those men you mentioned, never heard of any of them. It's really amazing because he thinks he understands the revolution and he doesn't understand anything about the revolution and he's a student of the revolution. So he goes big, the big broad ask, and he says, maybe it was British tyranny. Maybe you were just frustrated by the heavy hand of British tyranny, the boot on your neck all the time. And he says, never felt any of it. So he finally just says, what was it? What drove you onto the field of battle today? You were a young man and with a farm and a wife and a family. You had so much to lose. What drove you to the field of battle? And Levi Preston gives what I think is the greatest summary of the political philosophy of the American Revolution ever stated. And he said, son, when we went to face them redcoats that day, we meant only one thing. We had always governed ourselves, and we always meant to. And them redcoats, they meant that we shouldn't. That's it. That's the entire philosophy of the American Revolution. You don't need to read Patrick Henry's speech or George Washington's wisdom or Adams or Madison or Jefferson or any of them. What you need to know is what Levi Preston thought. That's the summary, and that's the summary of the American spirit today. There's no difference. That's who we are. Levi Preston, he is our forebearer. That's where we come from. That's wired into the American DNA. It's an extraordinary DNA, and if you've traveled the world, you know it's different than anywhere else. That idea that we're a self-governing people. Liberty, that's what we believe in. That's the idea. This is not just a country. It's an idea, and it's founded on that idea that our rights come from God and that we govern ourselves. We were given free will by the Lord. It doesn't come from the government. And this is really unique in all of human history. You ask, well, where does that come from in American history? This is another amazing thing about the way we learn American history in this country. I mean, I didn't realize this, how big the holes were in my own learning about American history. You know, if you think about the way we teach American history, at least in our public schools, if there are homeschoolers here, forgive me, because you guys know way more. But for those of us that learned in public schools, we learn it like this. You have the Pilgrims, right, come over, and they land at Plymouth Rock, and they have the Mayflower Compact, and you've got Jamestown, right? And then after the settlement at Jamestown, the next major event in American history that we learn in public school is the Revolution, right? Jamestown to the Revolution. Somebody asked me a few years ago, before I knew about this stuff, before I was reading all this history, and they said, Mark, how long was it between Jamestown and the beginning of the American Revolution? And I went into the file cabinet in my head to find that piece of information, and I found an empty drawer filled with dust, right? And couldn't even guess. No idea. I literally had no idea. And I thought and thought and thought. I said, 75 years? I don't know. And he told me it was 158 years between the Mayflower Compact and the beginning of the American Revolution. That's five generations. That's an extraordinary amount of time. I mean, think about that, 150 years where there's very little written about our history. Why is that? What was going on in the country during that 150 years, those five generations that led Levi Preston to say we'd always governed ourselves and we always would? What was going on is we were learning to govern ourselves, right? Our ancestors came over here, came across the ocean, and the crown, because of necessity, practiced benign neglect. You guys have probably heard that term. There wasn't really much they could do. We were really far away, right? And we weren't a bother, and it didn't really matter. And so we were over here learning. We brought some of our institutions with us. We brought a cultural heritage with us. We brought our faith with us. And based on those things, we built a system of self-governance that has never before been seen in human history. Extraordinary experiment was conducted here, in my opinion, divinely inspired, here on this continent over 158 years. So by the time Levi Preston is facing across that battlefield of those redcoats, he's saying, no way. My dad, my granddad, his granddad all governed themselves. They all decided for themselves. They all ran their lives and their communities as they saw fit. And now you're going to tell us what to do? No way. Not going to happen. And that's still in all of us. It's deep in our hearts. We grow up with it in America. Really unique. I was sitting with a journalist not long ago in Washington, D.C. This particular journalist was he lived part of his life here in America, but he's British, right? But he was raised until like the eighth grade here in America. In fact, in Indiana, actually, his dad was over here. And when we were sitting, he said, you know, there's something really unique about America that you might not understand. And the way that we put patriotism in our kids, and they grow up, and I know this isn't happening as much anymore, but he said, I grew up saying the Pledge of Allegiance. And it gave me this feeling of pride in being in America and being in my classroom and every morning get up and saying the pledge and sometimes singing the anthem. And he said, that's just not done in other countries around the world. And he said, so there's this unique thing that you put into your culture that's been there forever, and you probably, he said to me, you probably don't even appreciate it. And it's true, because I just grew up with it, right? And so we have this unique thing in our culture where we believe we're self-governing, and we're right. That's where the spark of liberty comes from. And today, we live in a society where we're losing that. We've been losing it for a long time, haven't we? Slowly, like the frog in the proverbial pot of hot water, slowly that water gets turned up day by day, month by month, administration by administration. They take our rights away from us, right? And first, they tell you what kind of car you can drive and how many miles to the gallon it has to get and what kind of gas you can put in it. They tell you what you can build your house out of, what you can do with your property, where you can put your pond or not, little by little every day. It doesn't matter. If you sit in your house, you can't look at anything that's in your house and not know that the government had a hand in telling how that was made, how it was sold, how you bought it, how much you paid for it. The government's involved in all of that stuff. For goodness sake, today they tell us what kind of toilet we can have in our houses, right? I want you to know how much of a rebel I am. I just built a new barn on my property. You put a bathroom in there. I put an illegal toilet in my barn. Is this going to be on TV? I could be in trouble here. We don't like it. It rubs us the wrong way. We get more and more uncomfortable every year, those of us who are conservatives. You know, it bothers us because we feel like we're losing that liberty. I talk to my parents. My dad's 77 years old. He says it's just not the same as it was when he was younger. There's just so much stuff we're not allowed to do. The government tells us what we can and can't do. It wasn't that way when he was a kid, when his parents were kids. And, you know, it's just every day we lose a little bit more. And we're intolerant of it now. Some of us are starting to rise up. 6 years ago, the Tea Party movement happened, right? And I saw a lot of you guys raise your hands. Thanks for being involved early on. And I was one of the people. I stood up early on. I didn't intend to lead anything. I was just a redneck in the country, minding my own business, and I was just frustrated. Anybody frustrated still? Yeah, we're all frustrated. So I was just frustrated. I stood up. I started volunteering. I kept raising my hand. You know how there's always a couple people in church or whatever there? Okay, I'll do that. Okay, yeah, I'll be there Saturday morning at 7. And I was one of those people. I just kept raising my hand. And because of that and God's grace, I ended up leading an organization that grew to 23 million members, 3,200 chapters across the country. I had no idea what was going on. Totally transformed my life. Took me from a very, very private person with an unlisted phone number living down at the end of a dirt road with no address on it to a guy who's on TV. It was crazy. Totally turned my life upside down because I was so frustrated with what was going on. I was willing to engage in that fight. And so many of you were and now are engaged in that fight as well. And so we did what Bob said, right? We went out and we thought, okay, what do you do when you want to change things? You elect different people. You elect better people. And we all thought, we haven't been electing good enough people. We haven't been paying close attention enough. We haven't been putting the right people in office. We haven't been keeping an eye on them. And you know what? All that stuff is true. But we all also believed, and I think somewhat naively at this point looking back, that if we put all these great people in office, if we paid attention to all these great people, if only that, then everything would change. We should have known better, to be honest. If you look back at the Reagan administration, right? Reagan himself promised to do away with the Department of Education, and he put a great man in charge to do it, probably the only secretary ever put in office with the charge of eliminating his agency, and that was Bill Bennett. And at the end of Bill Bennett's term and at the end of Ronald Reagan's term, the Department of Education was bigger than when they started. We should have known. It's kind of a clue. History provides clues. But we were enthusiastic, and we were a young movement, and we thought we could change the world. And we did the largest turnover in congressional history since 1938. That's extraordinary. All these new people in Washington, D.C., all this new blood, all this excitement, the Tea Party changes the world, and they get in there, and they get to work, and then nothing happens. Nothing changed. A lot of my compatriots in the Tea Party movement were frustrated. Some of them gave up. Because, God, if that wasn't enough, what would be? But you know what they told us in Congress? They told us, look, we're just one house. If you could give us the Senate, if you could work really hard, and if all you grassroots people can come out again and get engaged and fight for us and put the right people in office, then we'll have the Senate, and then we can start to return the country to the people. And you know what we did? We worked, and we went out, and we fought, and we walked districts, and we gave money, and we did everything we could do, and man, we got the Senate. Incredible, both houses of Congress in quote-unquote conservative control, and then what happened? Nothing. Nothing. Nothing happened. And you know what they told us next? If you could just give us the White House. If we have the White House, we'll have the House and the Senate, and we'll have the White House, and then everything will change. Everything will be better. You'll reach political nirvana, right? That's what they tell us. It's incredible. And you know what? I like to believe in stuff like that. I have a very vivid fantasy life, and I sit in my office barn sometimes. I put my feet up on my desk, my boots up on the desk. That's the only place my wife lets me put the boots on the desk. So I'm out in the barn with my feet up on the desk, and I like to imagine that it's 2017. Anybody hopeful? At least cautiously hopeful for 2000? Okay, so I am. And so I put my feet up, and I'm thinking, God, if we could just get a conservative president, right? Maybe there's some good candidates out there with good values, and maybe we get a conservative president. And then I imagine it's January of 2017. We've got a new executive just being sworn in. They just took their hand off the Bible, taking the oath of office, and they walk up to that podium, and at the podium, they stand there in front of the American people, and they say something like this. This is what I fantasize they're going to say. My fellow citizens, we've reached a historic crossroads in American history. We've reached a time when the federal government has outgrown all bounds ever imagined by the founders. We've reached a time when the federal government has outgrown the shackles placed upon it by the Constitution. And I pledge to you as your new president to spend the next 4 years reducing the power of the presidency, reducing the power of Congress, and reducing the power of the United States Supreme Court over the lives of the sovereign American citizen. How's that sound? Does that sound good? Does anybody believe any of them are going to say that? You know, I've said this all over the country, 30 states now, something similar to that. I haven't met one person who believes that the new president's going to say that. A president that you choose. Choose your most conservative candidate. I haven't met anybody who believes a president will say that. You know, when I say that to people and everybody laughs just like you did and we all chuckle together, it's not funny. That's the great American tragedy taking place right before our eyes. Because what we're saying is that we're going to go out and fight at the pinnacle of the American political system. And we're going to get the House and the Senate and the American presidency. We're going to win all that so that we can continue to lose our liberty. That's what we're saying. It's not acceptable. It's not acceptable. That can't possibly be enough. That can't be what the founders intended for us. I've got kids. I got a son. He's 19 years old. He'll be 20 years old next month, end of next month. He's a United States Marine. Really proud of him. He's in San Diego, based at Camp Pendleton right now. He took an oath to defend that Constitution, right? I can't tell my son, Jacob, that I'm in this political fight, that you've watched me travel around the country for 6 years, that our family has sacrificed because we have this terrible plan where we're going to lose. I can't say that to Jacob. He's out there, he's willing to risk his life for the Constitution. I can't say that to him. I have a 16-year-old daughter. She's a national-level debater. Her name's Lucy. Incredible girl. Raised a young conservative. Not easy to be a young conservative girl in the debate world. The debate world, if you guys don't know, in high school, is, I was going to say it's liberal, but that's not true. It's Marxist. And I mean that genuinely. I'm not saying that as rhetoric or hyperbole. I mean, these kids argue that Marxism is better than capitalism and that capitalism is bad. So this is the world my daughter has to live in. She went to a debate camp at Gonzaga University up in Washington State, right? There were 189 kids at that camp, 187 leftist Marxists, and my daughter and one friend. Incredible. I can't tell Lucy, hey, I'm so proud of you. You're getting this education. She wants to go to Hillsdale College. She's doing all this great stuff. She wants to be a lawyer. She wants to go into politics. I can't tell her, hey, by the way, honey, I'm working so hard so that we hand you a country that's completely trashed. We've got a great losing plan. And that's what our family's spending all their time and energy on. I can't say that to her. You guys can't say that to your kids or your grandkids or your nephews, nieces, and your neighbor's kids. We can't tell them that we have a plan that we know will not work. We all in this room acknowledge it won't work, and that's our plan. We can't do that. So if that's not enough, you have to ask yourself, if you're a patriotic American that loves this country, if that's not enough, you got to ask, what is then? There's got to be a solution. There's always a solution. Thank God for the founders, and I do mean thank God for the founders, because the founders were smart enough, and Bob told you the story how that second clause of Article 5 got into the Constitution. Thank God they realized that initially they had left out the ability for us, the people acting through our states, to amend that Constitution. Why did they want that ability in there? George Mason actually asked the question of the men assembled in that conference, in the Constitutional Convention. He asked them, do you really believe a government that's a tyranny will propose amendments to restrain its own tyranny? That's crazy, right? They all laughed, I'm sure, at the same thing. They all went, no, God, of course not, George. We should have thought of that. Same thing that we do today. It was so obvious, in fact, that Madison's notes reflect no debate. Man, they debated everything in that convention. I'm sure they debated what to have for lunch. They debated everything, no debate. They gave us, you and me, the right, acting through our state legislatures, brave men like the senator here, acting through our state legislatures, the right to restrain federal tyranny. That was the whole reason for Article 5. Do we have federal tyranny today? Yeah. Do we have a Congress that is spineless and out of control? Yeah. Do we have a president, and have we had presidents out of control? Operating outside the bounds of what you and I think the constitutional limits on that office should be? Yeah. And you know who's going to save us, though, right? Because we've got these folks in black robes at the Supreme Court, and they're going to... Well, never mind. I mean, if we didn't know they weren't going to save us before, do we know now? Goodness, they just actually came out and openly said, if Congress doesn't write the right law, they'll write it for them. They're attacking our religious liberty. The Supreme Court of the United States is attacking our religious liberty. They're not going to save us. Congress isn't going to save us. There is no president who can save us, but the founders knew that Levi Preston would save us. The founders knew that you would save us, that regular folks all over the country, and they gave us the tool. They put it right there in Article 5. They gave us the way to save it. So I think it's not just something we can use. It's not just something we should use. I think that we have an absolute, undeniable, unarguable moral obligation to use Article 5. Are you guys with me? So that's where we're at today. There are people who are going to tell you, well, that's crazy. You can't use Article 5. Way too scary. You might get a runaway convention. And I think about Washington, D.C. We have a runaway convention in Washington, D.C. right now, don't we? So we can take absolute surety that they are driving us over the cliff morally, fiscally, in a regulatory manner. They're driving us over the cliff right now. We know it's happening today, day in and day out. Every single day they're doing this to us, taking your liberty away. Or we as the citizens can stand and take control of it ourselves. Who do you trust more? Do you trust D.C. or do you trust the people of this country more? The people. Just like the founders did. I trust the people. You know, these people who will tell you about a runaway convention? You know, one of the things, I was just traveling with Senator Tom Coburn. You guys know who Coburn is? So I spent a couple of days with Tom. It's a real privilege. He's senior advisor to our project. I get to travel with him. I think he's, you know, you want to talk of Madison or an Adams or whatever, that's Tom Coburn. So I spent a couple of days with him traveling in Texas last week. And Coburn said to me, he's like, I've been in D.C. I was there 16 years. People trust them to fix stuff. That's just crazy. It's never going to happen. You know, Coburn presented every single year over $400 billion in waste and duplication on a nonpartisan basis, both parties participating, and over his last 8 or 10 years in Congress, out of $400 billion a year that he presented, they cut exactly zero. Not one penny. And he said it's never going to happen. In fact, he retired 2 years early because he said he couldn't fix it in D.C. And that's why he came to work for Convention of States. That's why we travel around together. So, you know, he was talking about the runaway convention, and it really irritates him when people talk about the runaway convention. And he said, you know, it is an argument that comes from a position of cowardice. These people are scared, and you'll hear them talk about fear. I'm so scared what might happen. I'm so fearful what might happen. Who knows what? We don't know what will happen. And Coburn, this is his words, he said, do they not understand our history? We're a history of people who faced fear. We're not a history of cowards. We're people who stand strong in the face of adversity. We're people who are willing to take risks. We're a people who built a country by challenging the word impossible. They fought the Redcoats, the British Empire. We fought World War II. We fought against one of the greatest war machines ever assembled in the Nazis. We fought and beat the Nazis. We fought and beat communism. We put a man on the moon. Oh, but we can't use Article 5. It's way too scary. That's craziness. And let's talk craziness. I'm so tired of hearing this runaway convention argument. I'm just tired of it because it's crazy. I mean, it is downright, straight up crazy. Let me explain why. You know, Bob laid it out perfectly. It takes 38 states to ratify any amendment. Remember, a convention only proposes. Its job? Make suggestions. The suggestions go out to the state. This math is really important. I'm not a math guy, and I'm a lawyer, so I'm a language guy, but I can do a little simple math. If it takes 38 states to ratify, that means it takes only 13 states to stop anything, right? So let's imagine for a moment that the convention goes crazy and runs away. I'll explain to you why it can't, but let's imagine it does. It just goes completely crazy, and they start to do things to take away our liberty. Maybe they start to do things to affect our Second Amendment right to keep and bear arms. Maybe they affect our First Amendment religious freedoms. I mean, they're doing this stuff already, but let's presume the convention runs away and does all this crazy stuff. Let's say they even manage to pass out a couple of amendments, suggested amendments, that do these horrible things, and then it goes out to the states. This is what you have to believe if you believe in the runaway convention. And I just want you to remember, I'm saying this language is really important. You must believe this if you believe in the runaway convention. If you're thinking, oh, I'm scared about this runaway thing, then this is in your head behind it. It cannot be without this thought. You have to believe that the 13 most conservative states in this country, and usually it's most likely going to be by one house in each of those 13 states, right? They're going to pass something that limits your liberty. You have to believe that the 13 most conservative houses in the United States of America, filled with the 13 most conservative groups of legislators in the United States of America, are going to do something to take away your liberty. Right? States, the most conservative states, Mississippi, Alabama, South Carolina, North Carolina, Georgia, Oklahoma, you got to believe those legislators in those states are going to vote to take away your liberty. You have to believe that. I've been in all those states. I've been in all of those legislatures. That's just downright crazy. But you got to believe that if you believe in the runaway. Here's the other stuff you got to believe that's just so crazy. You know, when we pass these applications, and the senator talked about this, the language has to be identical for each state, right? So we've got this model language. It's limited to three areas, things that would limit the federal government on a fiscal basis, restrain them fiscally, things that would limit the scope and jurisdiction of the federal government. That gives me chills every time I say that. Limit the scope and jurisdiction of the federal government, right? I just love that one. And pass term limits on members of Congress and maybe even the Supreme Court. They all sound pretty good, right? So every state passes that same application, that same resolution. You know what that is? That's the law of convention. Just like when the senator here, they pass legislation here, there's a law. The law is now the law of convention. These are the only things that can be discussed in convention. And people will say to me, the runaway people, oh, but you don't know what those delegates will do when they get to convention. Or they can just go crazy in convention. They could just ignore what they were told to do. You know, each delegate to convention, they're called a commissioner, and they each carry with them a piece of paper. It's called a commission. That commission says what they can and cannot do. And here in Indiana, the senator described, you guys even put stricter limitations on your delegates, criminal penalties if they don't do what they're supposed to do. So these are things you got to believe if you believe in the runaway. You got to believe they're going to ignore the law of convention, the majority of them, all these conservatives. You got to believe they're going to ignore their commissions. You got to believe, you believe that if you believe in the runaway. And maybe you do. You know what? Maybe they're drinking Kool-Aid at convention. I don't know, I hear they have really good Kool-Aid at some conventions. So maybe they're all drinking Kool-Aid and they all get out of control and they all ignore the law of convention. And then you got to believe that not a single delegate in that convention hall, not the most conservative delegate, doesn't raise their hand and say, excuse me, point of order. That's not germane to this convention. We're only allowed to discuss these three things. You got to believe not one person raises their hand and objects, right? Here's another thing you got to believe. Now, I hope the senator is there as a delegate, but maybe he's not. Maybe he's at home. Are you going to be watching your delegation when they're in convention? Oh, you mean you're not just going to ignore them at the most important political event in history? So this is what you got to believe. You got to believe that great men like this senator are going to send delegates there who are going to not follow the law convention, who are not going to listen to their commission, and then the senators here at home, or the representatives or assemblymen, whatever they are in any given, are not going to pay any attention to what they're doing. Because you realize if your delegate gets out of control, then the senator and his compatriots pick up the phone and say, stop or come home. You're fired. And in here, in this state, and you'll be facing a felony when you get home, right? So you got to believe that none of that's going to happen. Then you have to believe 26 states, the majority of states, are going to pass something crazy. You know, today, 31 states have both houses controlled by Republicans. But you got to believe 26 states are going to pass something that's going to limit your liberty. You got to believe that if you believe in the right. It's crazy. And then in the end, you got to believe it's going to come out of convention. And guess what? No great conservative lawyers are going to challenge it. Oh, yeah, Mark Levin and Landmark Legal Foundation, they're just going to be quiet and sit back and let it run away, right? ACLJ, Heritage Foundation, Cleta Mitchell, all these great conservative lawyers, they're all just going to ignore it. You got to believe that, though, if you believe in the runaway. And then in the end, you've got to believe the 13 most conservative states in America are going to vote to take away your guns, take away your it's just crazy. So if I sound a little worked up about this, I am, because I'm tired of hearing people say crazy stuff and tell us we should be scared of the only remedy that the founders gave us for this exact situation. This is the remedy that they gave us. You know, there's a reason that I do this, and I talked about my kids, and that's an important reason that I do this, and I think back to the founders, and that's an important reason that I do this. But there's a story that I carry with me all the time that comes out of just being an activist. You know, we get to do this. I get to travel around the country and do this because there are over 30,000 small donors across the country that support what we do. And there are a lot of those when I was a member of Tea Party Patriots, a lot of the donors, you know, there were even more donors than that to Tea Party Patriots. And I always try to look through the donor list. You know, I can't call 30,000 people, but I try to call a lot of them, as many as I possibly can, especially if I see people giving more than once, because it really matters to me. You know, a lot of organizations, they take checks from people, and it doesn't mean a lot to them. It's just their budget. And to me, I know when I see somebody, especially somebody gives 10 bucks or 15 bucks, that means that it was hard for them to give that money, probably. They probably couldn't afford it. You know the story of the widow's mite, right? And that's what I think of when I see a $10 donor or a $15 donor. I think that's probably somebody that hurt them. You know, fixed income, came out of their budget or whatever. And so I look for those, and I'm always trying to call people like that. I talk to a lot of donors around the country all the time. In this movement, a lot of them are actually volunteers as well. So it's really, they're just double extraordinary people. A few years ago, I saw one of these donors on the list, and they kept appearing over and over. And this donor's name was Alice, and she lived in Dallas. I could refer to her as Alice from Dallas, and her name is Alice Schleck, actually. But she was a pretty big donor, and I would see $1,000, $1,500, $5,000, and this was like a repeating pattern. And so eventually, I got around to picking up the phone and calling Alice. And when I called Alice, when they answered the phone, it was a care facility. And I was a little bit, I don't know, I guess I was just surprised. I just wasn't expecting that. I don't know why, I just wasn't, right? And so they answered, and it was a care facility in Dallas, and I told them who I wanted to talk to. I asked for Alice by name, and they went and got her and brought her to the phone for me. And it took a long time for Alice to get to the phone, and I was picturing probably what you're picturing, right? She was an older lady, trouble getting to the phone, and wheelchair or walker, whatever. That's what I was picturing when she came to the phone. And so I was a little, I don't know, like I said, I was a little shaken just because I wasn't expecting this. And, you know, I'm thinking, wow, man, she's in a care facility and she's still writing checks because she's still in the fight. That's pretty cool. And so she gets on the phone, and I had been on Fox News the night before. And so I introduced myself and told her who I was. And the first thing she says, which always makes me uncomfortable, she goes, oh, my God, I saw you on Fox News last night. I can't believe you're calling me. And I said, you know, Alice, I'm calling you because you're the hero. It's not me. I'm on Fox News, but you're in the fight. And, you know, you're writing these checks, and we get to do what we're doing, and we get to be in the fight because you're in the fight. I want you to know how much we appreciate that. We had a nice little chat, and I said, I'm going to be coming to Dallas soon. I'd really like to take you out to lunch when I come to Dallas. And she said, "Oh, honey, you don't want to date me. I'm almost 100 years old." And I told Alice, you know, my wife would kill me if she thought I was asking you out on a date, Alice, but I still want to take you out to lunch. And I did eventually get to take Alice out to lunch. And I went to Dallas, had a chance to sit down for lunch with Alice, and her sprightly 66-year-old son, Barry, came with us and, you know, took her out of the home and brought her. And she was in a walker and a wheelchair. You know, he brought her out of the home in the wheelchair, and she used her walker to get into the restaurant. She was so amazing because she was so with it. She was living in this care facility, but she knew everything that was going on politically. We were going through the elections, and she was going through all the candidates. I mean, she's talking who's Michelle Bachmann and Herman Cain and all the candidates are. And she was just dialed in. And I was so fascinated that, you know, here she was almost 100 years old, and she was still engaged, still writing checks, still knew who all the candidates were. She was so funny. She orders a big old beer, right? It's like this tall, and she's like this tall. And this big beer comes to the table, and she says, the beer comes to the table, and she says to her son, "Oh, I don't know if I'm going to be able to drink that whole thing." And he goes, "Oh, come on, Ma, quit trying to impress him. You do it every Thursday." She's like, "Stop it, stop it." So she's drinking her beer over lunch. We're having all this great political talk, and I learned a lot from her. I learned a lot of history, a lot of perspective, a lot about politics, a lot about her views, just life views, and we stayed in touch, and I saw her a few times after that. I have an incredible picture of her, me and her at her son's house out by the pool. She's got her head on my shoulder. She was very flirty. Thank God my wife is not a jealous woman. So me and Alice had a thing going, and she died about maybe a year and a half ago. She was 101 years old when she passed away. And she was still giving, and she was still reading the paper, and still watching the news. She was still engaged. You know, I was with her son last week in Dallas with Senator Coburn and her son Barry, and he'd never heard this story that I told him. I tell your mom's story all over the country. He's like, "Wow, I can't believe my mom's famous. She would have loved it." And so I tell you that story, and I carry Alice with me everywhere I go, because I always think about this. If she was 101 years old and she was still fighting for the future of our country, I can never quit. We can never quit. Alice Schleck is all over this country. She's 100 years old and she's 10 years old, right? And she's 50 years old. She's everywhere. That spirit is all over this country. And if Alice Schleck can fight until she's 101 years old, then we can never quit. I'm never going to quit. That's why I'm here with you today. That's why I'm promoting the Convention of States. What I need you specifically to do, if you're not involved, is get involved. Because it's not up to me. And Alice did everything she could do, and now it's up to you. It's up to citizens. It's up to the Levi Preston and every one of you. And what you guys can do is get involved. You have incredible leadership here in the state. You already saw some of them up on the stage. There are more. You can be a district captain in your own district and get involved. You can go to conventionofstates.com and you can sign the petition, and that petition will go to your state legislator. The senator will tell you it's important. They hear from you guys. They know that you have their back. They know that you want them in the fight, because when the people, crazy people, come to their office yelling at them about a runaway convention, they need to know there are more of you than there are of them. So what I'm asking you to do, what I'm pleading with you to do today, is to be involved, to be Levi Preston, to help us save the country. So God bless you all for being here. God bless the great state of Indiana. God bless the United States of America. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. So we're going to take some questions. Nothing's off limits. Go for it. Hostile, friendly. We don't care. What's that? You want the microphone? Yeah. Bob, why don't you join me up here and you can answer questions. There's a microphone right here. If you have a question, raise your hand. We'll bring the microphone over to you. And really important to me when we do this, and we have to be really careful of this everywhere we go, it's a question. That's really important. And we'll do our best to answer your question. And if you feel like we didn't adequately answer your question, what we're going to do is move on. But we'll stick around afterwards. We'll have whatever dialogue you want. But we want to be able to give as many people a chance to ask questions as we can. So we try to keep them short and just a quick interchange. So raise your hand if you have a question. Or there you go. He's going to bring the microphone to you so everybody can hear you. And so you can be famous on TV.
Terry Fennig. And I'm wondering if you have a target proposal for an amendment that you would like the convention to first focus on?
So as an organization, we don't promote any particular amendment. Our job is to help it get to convention. But I can tell you what some of my personal favorites are. What I'm most interested in is what the American people want. I can tell you what I want, but I've learned to trust the wisdom of the American people. They're way smarter than I am. Anytime I'm different from what most of the American people think, I'm usually wrong. And so what I find if I really think about it. So the American people for 30 years, 80% of them say they want a balanced budget amendment of some kind. Well, I think we should probably have that. They probably know, you got to balance your own checkbook, right? The government doesn't. That's a problem. We know it's a problem, so we got to fix that. By the way, this is how bad our financial situation is. This comes from Coburn, from traveling with him. I learned a lot traveling with him last week. Right now, we have roughly, in this number, you brought up kind of this number, $140 trillion in unfunded liabilities. That's 1.5 times the value of every asset, government or private, in the United States of America. It's incredible. So we need to balance our budget. We need to get that in. Second for me would be a term limits amendment. And this is interesting because I'm not necessarily a huge fan of term limits. We have them in California and it hasn't worked real well. Coburn is a big fan of term limits, so we had this debate a little bit. But what I am in favor of is 80% of Americans want it. We should at least have the discussion about it, and I think we should probably have it if 80% of Americans want it. Bob, I know you have some interest.
Well, one idea that I wrote about was the idea of, the term they used back in the founding era was not term limits, but it was rotation in office. And what they had in the Articles of Confederation was they didn't have term limits, but what they did have was no consecutive terms. So you actually had to take not just one, but two terms off between elections. So that's one idea. Another idea, if you think about it, is probably the biggest area fiscally that they're running away in is basically what I would call Commerce Clause abuse. The Senator mentioned this also. If you were to get to the original idea of the Commerce Clause, which was really mostly to keep commerce regular, now it's been flipped as exactly 180 degrees out of whack. It was in there for one reason, and that was to stop the states from erecting trade barriers between the states. So the Commerce Clause said, nope, we're taking that away from the states, and we're going to federalize that, and here's why we think it's appropriate. That has been completely turned around. If we were to have some fidelity to the original idea of the Commerce Clause, almost immediately, 40% of official Washington would disappear. One department after another. I analyzed this department by department. All the departments that, Commerce Clause,
Energy.
Commerce, Energy, Education, gone at one after another.
Well, and I want to give a shout out to Fairtax Dave, because one of my favorites would be, let's do away with the 16th Amendment, which is the direct income tax. Do away with the, anybody in favor of doing away with the IRS in here? Yeah. So I think that's, and I want to say that's probably, that sounds really radical, and it's probably the most radical that's actually a viable amendment. I actually think we could get it done in a convention, because people don't love the IRS. I'm just being gentle with our friends at the IRS. Do you have somebody back? Yep, right back there, and then we'll come to you, Senator.
Kevin Cox from Marion. I'm not sure if I have a good way to ask this to where you'll understand it, but seems like there's so much, when you're talking about the unfunded liabilities for the pensions of the unions, that the federal government is one of the largest employers of all unionized workers, and then you try to have this convention that reins in the government and eliminates all these departments like you're talking about. Well, what happens when all of those people basically, you got all these pensions, so I don't understand how that ends up working in the long run. Not that I defend them or think that that's right, because in my opinion, I don't think there should be any type of unionization of federal workers in the first place, because their pockets are in.
So there's two pieces to that. I understand exactly what you're saying. So the question, you can't just do away with federal pensions. First of all, it's not fair to those people, right? These people made a bargain, whether we think it was a good bargain for the country or not, they made a bargain, they worked their lives, they built up these pensions, and they have a right to collect these pensions. And I don't really have a problem with that. It's sad because of all this money, but the reality is that's a bargain that they made. And the greatest tragedy going on in America today is all the politicians know the dirty secret, which is they won't be able to pay these pensions if we continue doing what we're doing, right? And so really the people who the ugly joke is being played on are the people who believe they're earning those pensions. And so we need to fix that. My opinion of the way to fix that, first of all, there should be an amendment making it unconstitutional for there to be collective bargaining unions in any government level. And that should just be unconstitutional. And then we need to figure out how to tier that down for people who exist in the system right now so that we can do our best to pay out the people who are owed. And ultimately, they may end up taking a haircut depending on what happens financially in the country.
The other aspect of your question was an economics question, and that is, what do we do with these people if the federal government is smaller and those people are all of a sudden out of a job? Obviously, there's going to be some level of attrition, right? So some of these people are going to retire and they're not going to be heard from again. But the younger people who are still working, what's going to happen to them if they don't have a job? Same thing happens to every one of us. We don't have a job. We go out and get one. And economically, people are freed up to do more productive things. There was a time in this country where, you know, something like 95% of Americans were farmers or in agriculture. And what happened? You know, if you had said to somebody, you know, 100 years ago that we're going to have a bunch of dinosaur juice and it's going to power these amazing contraptions and they're going to do our harvesting for us, people would have then said, well, where in the world are those people going to work? Right, if they don't need to be farmers anymore, well, they find their way in a new economy. The ultimate resource is our mind, because we're always finding ways to grow, and people are being freed up from less productive activity. It's, pardon me, some of you are government employees, but it's very hard to think of too many things that are less valuable, especially at the federal level in departments that shouldn't be there than that. So they're freed up for more productive work.
Go to the senator there.
Was out of a concern, and maybe Bob, you can answer this best. What do we do? Let's say we go through this process, and this is my biggest fear, is we end up in court. Mm-hmm. You know it's going to end up in court. And then we get to the Supreme Court, who has just recently decided, as you said, they will make the law because they think it will be too chaotic for the country to go through a real Article 5 convention and have to deal with some of these issues, which are going to be hard issues for us. What's the plan when we get past that point? How do we conquer the Supreme Court to really fix this? And what's the answer if we get a stop signal from the Supreme Court that says you can't do this anymore? So this may have been a good idea, but you can't do this.
Yeah. So a big part of that, Senator, is how we posture from the start. And this is really important. So one of the things that we talk to all our sponsors about, and we talk about this in every state we're in, is you don't require the permission of the federal government to hold a convention in the first place. Because the threshold question is, what happens if they don't call it? Right? You get 34 identical applications and then Congress just does nothing. What happens? Or they go to the courts and say, we don't believe this is valid. And the answer is, you as a senator are acting as a representative of a sovereign state. And as a sovereign state, you retain the right to call a convention at any time without federal government permission. So this is really important that you as state legislatures have the attitude, we don't need no stinking Congress. We don't need no stinking Supreme Court. And the reality is, what I would encourage all state legislators to steel themselves to have the attitude going in that the Supreme Court has no authority in this area. You are a sovereign state, and the Supreme Court has no authority over a sovereign state acting in its sovereign capacity. And so I don't really care what the Supreme Court does, and it's really important that we steel ourselves for that. And I can tell you, if you look at Supreme Court jurisprudence leading up to now, it's not necessarily going to hold. But the Supreme Court has repeatedly said some 40-odd times that the federal government has no authority over an Article 5 process. So we just need to be ready for that fight. I don't disagree with you that I think it will come. And I can tell you some of the greatest conservative constitutional lawyers in America are preparing to make that argument outside the confines of the court. Because what we just need to do is convince the American people, look what they're trying to do. They're trying to stop you from exercising your sovereignty over the federal government. So it's a pretty rough and tumble answer, but that's, yeah.
Can you recount the sponsors, the people who have, the well-known people who publicly endorsed,
sure,
not just Article 5,
sure,
but even specifically COS.
Yeah, so, and this is something that makes this whole movement different today. You have a senator that's really extraordinary here in this room, and I'm not stroking him, but he was engaged in this 6 years ago. That's really incredible. That is, I mean, I don't know the rest of your record, I'm just telling you on that, that's extraordinary, and I meet a few people like you around the country that years ago got this. And they, back when he was doing this, people were just generally saying, what? Article 5? That's, now there's a whole bunch of us, right? It's way easier for folks who are legislatively coming on board now. You got Mark Levin and Rush Limbaugh and Glenn Beck and Sean Hannity. All those people have endorsed the Convention of States project specifically. Colonel Alan West has endorsed, Governor Bobby Jindal, Governor Mike Huckabee. I mean, you just got extraordinary public figures that are endorsing. At the sort of public intellectual level, people who are scholars, you've got Randy Barnett, who runs the Georgetown Center for the Constitution at Georgetown School of Law. I mean, he's an extraordinary, probably the greatest libertarian scholar of the Constitution in America. I would argue the greatest conservative academic scholar in America today is Robbie George at Princeton, and he's on our legal board of reference. We've got C. Boyden Gray, former White House counsel, on our legal board of reference. We have Chuck Cooper, who is the premier constitutional litigator for the NRA, is on our legal board of reference. So these are people, you know, you'll hear people say, oh, you're going to trash the Second Amendment. Chuck Cooper just came out with a letter, by the way, saying, you know, as a guy who's been litigating on behalf of the Second Amendment for most of my career, who was the constitutional attorney for Reagan, I'm not accustomed to being accused of trying to trash the Second Amendment, right? So these are the people who are now on board. So I think that partially goes to answer your question. And that group of people just keeps growing and growing and growing. Professor John Eastman from the Claremont College. I mean, these people just keep adding on, what's his name? The guy who wrote the book about the Andy McCarthy, wrote the book about the grounds to impeach the current president and wrote about the terrorist threat to the United States. He's one of the greatest U.S. federal prosecutors. So all these people just keep adding their names. I sat in a meeting with, sitting across from me, to me it's like I felt like a little kid, Ed Meese was sitting across from me, right? Sitting next to me is Mark Levin, right? I felt like a little kid. C. Boyden Gray's in the room, all these professors I just named are in the room, Mike Ferris. By the way, Mike Ferris, who's my co-founder on this project, I say Madison, you say Mike Ferris. It's like the same, it's in the same breath. Mike Ferris is one of the few constitutional litigators in the United States of America ever to argue Article 5 before the United States Supreme Court, one of the literally top guys in the country, the guy who made homeschooling legal in America. Do you guys know that in the 70s, homeschooling was illegal? You didn't have the right to school your own kids at home? Unbelievable. In 50 states, it was that way. You know what Mike Ferris did? He said, well, that's wrong. He was a young constitutional litigator. You know what people told Mike Ferris when he said, oh, I'm going to fix that? You're crazy. That's impossible. It's illegal in 50 states. What are you going to do? Your young lawyer was probably 30 years old when he embarked on this crusade, and he made it legal in all 50 states. So these are the kind of people that are in the army and leading the fight. There'll be a lot more of them by the time we get to that point. Back here.
Dale Parrish, district captain for District 85. My question is actually two parts. First of all, directed toward the senator, what are the chances, realistically, of the Indiana application getting approved in the next legislature? Then the second part is, let's be optimistic here, let's say it all gets approved and Indiana's on board. What will our role, Mark, be from that point on? Once our application is approved, okay. Our role in the state I'm talking right. about.
Senator?
Sure. I think we have very good chances. It was sort of a situation that played out this last year. And part of this was, and I'll accept as much blame as what Senator Long would probably say. He would say it was his fault. I would say it was my fault. We had our discussions about Article 5 and the resolution that I carried in caucus. But when we went to the Judiciary Committee, we had great folks lined up from Convention of States came and testified. We had some other folks there to testify in support. Very few people spoke against it. But then we had actually two Republican senators that spoke out against it. And really broadsided me. I had no idea that was going to happen. And I think one of them actually was kind of a spur of the moment thing that when that senator made the statement that was made, and it ended up in a tie vote in the Judiciary Committee, which means it just didn't have a constitutional majority. It could have been brought up again. And that hearing was in room 130, which is in the lower level of the State House. And I was absolutely aghast when that came out in a tie vote. And I left that room, I think you were there, Diane, just said a few words to the folks and went straight to Senator Long's office. The potential of those two Republican legislators to do anything constructive under his power, it's lost because he, if you understand, he was so angry with those folks for what they had done. And we have already talked since. We've had a couple of discussions about where we go this next session with this legislation, because it'll either be moved to a committee where we will be guaranteed it will pass, or it'll go to a committee, that same committee, and it will be comprised of different state Republican senators, because I think he was so angry. He'll pull some of those people off that committee because of some of the nonsense and some of the craziness that they said, some of the same stuff that we've talked about here. That just absolutely makes no sense whatsoever. So I think there is hope for that. I don't think this is on a lot of people's radar, which, to be honest with you, is good. The people who support it. Those who don't, it's just kind of flying below the radar for those folks, and they don't understand it, and they don't think it's ever going to be an issue. So I think it's really kind of a time made for us coming up here. So,
and thank you for your steadfast support.
Sure.
We really appreciate it. So, and as to what you do after you guys pass it here, you continue to organize. And the reason that that's, there's a couple reasons that's so important. First is there's going to be a ratification fight. I don't know when, when we go around and talk about, people ask me all the time, how long is it going to take? And it's an important question. My crystal ball's not very good, and I'm a super optimistic person. Coburn says, and I think he has a lot more experience than I do, I know he does, he figures it's going to take us maybe 3 years to get to 34 states. But we also both agree on this. In any kind of a social movement, which is what this is, there comes a tipping point. Social scientists call it a preference cascade. And you never know exactly when that moment comes. When do you get over the edge? When does it go crazy? And there's the potential in 2016 for a major preference cascade. And the reason for that is we have a presidential election. And you already have this bubbling through the presidential network. You've got Kasich is an Article 5 guy. You've got Jindal's an Article 5 guy. Huckabee's an Article 5 guy. Rand Paul's an Article 5 guy. Ted Cruz is nibbling around the edges. He was an Article 5 guy. He got some pressure in Texas when he was running for the Senate, so he sort of backed off. But you've got the majority of candidates that are pro-Article 5. So if it becomes an issue, and that's really up to you guys, if you're contacting the candidates and saying, hey, what's your position on Convention of States? Don't say Article 5, really important. What's your position on the Convention of States movement? And you push them. If you go when they have a town hall here or in Indianapolis and you ask that question, what's your position? I want to know what your position is on a Convention of States to return the power back to the people. They will become an issue. Coburn told me, here's inside stuff, he said he's talking to all the debate folks, and he says it's going to be a question in one of the debates. So potentially, if that happens, you could see a preference cascade. And if the candidates or a candidate starts to say, this is what's most important is returning the power to the people, you could see it happen in 16. So, but we need you to stay in the fight. Well, and I was going to say there's actually a bigger, broader reason. You know, my organization is called Citizens for Self-Governance. And there's a reason for that. Because we have to create citizens for self-governance. Because even if we go all the way through this, the senator does his work and gets it passed here, and we get that work done in 33 other states, it's already done in 4, so if we get it done here, then we're down to 29, we get it 29 other states, and even if we go to convention and get good amendments, and even if we get those amendments ratified, right, we can't go to sleep. We have to have citizens who are willing to stand and fight for self-governance, because what that's going to mean, by the way, is if we get this all done, there's going to be a lot more power here in your state. There's going to be a lot more money here in your state. A lot of that money that goes to the federal government, now it's going to stay right here in Indiana. And it's going to be up to you guys and your local senators and representatives to be in control of that, to be self-governing citizens. And so this network that we're building is bigger than Convention of States. It's intended to build a network of self-governing folks who will stand in the breach forever. Right down here? Oh, right in front of you, since you already asked a question. Oh, can you pass that up one, please? This gentleman right here in front of you. Oh, I thought you raised, I'm sorry, go ahead. I thought it was you.
Is there any bipartisan support at all for this, or is this basically a conservative right-wing movement?
I would say it's right now bipartisan support is limited. I can point out limited examples, but I don't want to overstate it. For example, in Ohio, we have a Democrat and a Republican co-sponsor. And so Christina Hagan, the youngest member ever of elected to the Indiana, or I'm sorry, the Ohio legislature, Representative Bill Patman, a senior Democrat, African-American gentleman, are co-sponsors there. So we have that co-sponsorship there. To be fair, he's a conservative, very conservative Democrat. So it's a little bit odd. There aren't many of those left in the country, unfortunately. But he's a true statesman, wonderful guy. We had some folks in West Virginia. West Virginia is a little bit of an odd because it's a coal state. It's moving red, but it's a purple state right now. So we have some Democrats there who helped out, mostly no. And I think that's really a shame because, you know, I'm a conservative. I'm unabashed conservative. This is not a conservative versus a liberal issue. And this is what's so interesting. And you'll see, if you go out and do some research on me, you'll see people on the right give me grief because I go talk to and work with people on the left. You know, I always feel like if you're not willing to go into the lion's den, then what kind of a warrior are you, right? I go speak at Berkeley. I've spoken at Harvard. I don't care. Ultra liberal. Those are more fun than speaking to the choir. Right, and so we'll go do that anywhere. But here's what I say when I talk to people. I want to simplify this issue. It's really important. You're not going to remember all this stuff. You're not going to remember all the stuff I said. You're not going to get on stage and talk about this stuff. But there is a really simple way to present the Convention of States to pretty much anybody, and you don't have to worry about whether they're your crazy left-wing aunt or your crazy right-wing uncle. Just ask them this question. Between the folks in Washington, D.C., and you at home in your own community, who do you want deciding? Who decides? Who should make the decisions about the things that affect your life? It's a really simple question. You know what answer you get? Like, I go to Berkeley, California. You know what they say when I ask that question? Well, we should decide here in Berkeley, right? Crazy Berkeley, Austin, Texas. Keep it weird, Austin. We should decide here in Austin, Texas, right? And then I go to Lubbock, Texas, about as conservative as get. Who should decide? We should decide here. And Americans agree on this. 72% of Americans today say the federal government's too big and does too much. By the way, there aren't 72% of Americans that are Republicans or Tea Partiers or conservatives. So the majority of us feel the same way. And you know what I say to my friends in Berkeley, California? I would fight and die for their right to decide in Berkeley, California. And if I lived there, thank goodness I don't, I would fight against them on almost everything they want to do in Berkeley, California. I hate what they do in Berkeley, California. It's a socialist city. Right? And I would fight against it, and if I really didn't like it, I could move out. That's why I don't live there. But what this is all about is a simple question. Do you think Washington, D.C. should decide, or do you think you and your neighbors should decide? You ask that question that way. If people say, what's Convention of States all about? I say, it's about who decides, Washington or you. That's really what you need to know when you talk to your friends and neighbors about this. Do you think Washington, D.C. should decide, or do you think us and our neighbors and friends should decide? And they'll always tell you that they should decide. So I think it's sad that it's partisan, but here's the reality. I'm a conservative guy. Mike Ferris is a conservative guy. That list of names. I mean, I imagine myself going to a website and looking and seeing, you know, all these crazy leftists on this website and saying, is that something I want to support? No. I think I'll stay away from that. But what I think will happen is over time they will come around. And they will come around mainly because the majority of states in America are conservative, 31, both houses Republican. It's gonna get rolling and they're gonna wanna be at the table. When the game's afoot, they're gonna wanna play. So that's what I think is gonna happen.
Yeah, I have one thing I wanna add to that though. We are at the peak of our strength right now. So, you know, I'm a sports fan. If you watch football, sometimes your team is in a rebuilding mode and they say, you know, this year is just kind of about putting the team back on the field. Next year, that's where we're going to win the championship, whatever it is. It could be basketball, it could be football, whatever it is. And sometimes I go around to different state legislatures, and I sometimes hear people say that. It's like, well, you know, we didn't get it this year. We might come close this year, but the following year, next, it's always next year, right? You listen to politics, it's always it's the next election. As I said earlier,
We are at the peak of our strength right now. This is not for way down the road. This is for the next legislative session that we have. We have got to make this happen while we can. As I said earlier, if we miss this opportunity, we are going to go down in history as they did in the late 80s and early 90s as a generation that missed a great opportunity. We cannot miss that opportunity. I want my kids to live in freedom, and I think all of us do too. We want that future. That's a future that's worthy of us.
So let's one last question to close? I always like to close with one last one, if it's okay.
Yeah.
Steve Tucker.
Hey, Steve.
Just a quick statement. I just don't understand why our presidential candidates right now are not on what you just talked about, eliminating the IRS. It just seems mm-hmm. like such a bipartisan, easy, not too many people want that on their back. But right. A quick question on the kind of the mechanics I'm a little muddy on, maybe sure. the senator can answer. How does it start? Does it start in the Senate and then get voted in and then go to the House, or can it go reverse?
It can go either way, and it's different in every state.
Yeah.
And what we try to do, you know, we leave it up to our state director, our legislative liaison, our sponsors, and they'll generally tell us they know what's going on inside their houses and their Senate way better than we do. And what we try to do is, sometimes you want to get it through the weaker house first. Sometimes you want to get it through the stronger house first. They'll tell us how it plays. I was just in Ohio, and they got a weird thing going on. They did the BBA as well, and that started in the Senate. So the Senate's all funny. They're like, well, then you start this one in the House and bring it to us, and we'll pass. So it just depends on the state and the politics in the state. We're following the lead here of the people who know what's going on. Remember, we're a real bottom-up organization. We believe that the knowledge and the skill and the passion are on the ground. They're not in my barn in Northern California. So we're going to have to close out, and I apologize, but we're going to stick around, and we'll hang out and answer all the questions you want. We'll be here as late as you want. So just, I want to close by just thanking you guys for being here. By being here in this auditorium tonight, you've proven yourself to be great patriots. You could be at home, you could be doing other things, but you care so much about the future of your nation that you came out today. So I'd like to close. You guys should give yourselves a round of applause. Thank you very much.